at Prashanthi Kutiram, which is located in Jigni at Gethalhalli on the outskirts of Bangalore, which is 30 kilometers from central Bangalore and located beyond Electronic City, the IT hub of the Silicon City, Bangalore. As I entered this campus, I feel surrounded by positive aura. I plan to spend this entire day at Prashanthi Kutiram, which I call as the abode for health and wellness. Prashanthi Kutiram is also known as Vyasa, Vivekananda Yoga Anusandhana Samsthana Campus. This campus is spread over 100 acres and I am here to learn, understand and share with you all on how yoga can be used for therapeutic intervention and also personalized to individual needs. Join and stay with me in enjoying this experience at Vyasa. I will be covering this day's experience in four different episodes. In this first episode, I will be in conversation with Dr. H.R. Nagendra and Dr. R. Nagaratna, the founders, and understand from them the motivation behind starting this initiative and also their viewpoint on yoga being a therapeutic intervention. I will also be in conversation with Madhva, who is going to assist me through the day, taking me through Vyasa. We will understand from him about the different aspects of Vyasa and he will take us through the history behind Vyasa and the entire journey. Let us begin this day by starting from one of the world's largest Vivekananda statue.
Arogyadhama is an epitome of health and wellness. They focus here on an integrated approach of using modern medicine along with yogic practices and naturopathy and several other techniques to provide a very positive health experience. And also on the wellness, they provide something related to drugless therapy. Madhva, who was my colleague at Wipro for 2 decades, has been here at Arogyadhama. Thank you so much, Madhva. I'm looking forward for spending the day here at Arogyadhama.
Welcome, Sujata, and welcome team Digital Wellness, part of Digi Next Health. Pleasure to introduce Vyasa and Arogyadhama to the viewers of Digital Wellness. Vyasa, which is Vivekananda Yoga Anusandhana Samsthana, has been established for almost 30 years now under the guidance and leadership of Dr. H.R. Nagendra, awarded the Padma Shri in 2016. There are broadly 3 components of Vyasa. So we have a university which trains graduates at the level of a Bachelor of Science in Yoga, a Master of Science in Yoga, a PhD in Yoga, along with MD and postdoc opportunities for medical professionals. There are also diploma and postgraduate diploma courses for yoga therapists. The second part is Anveshana, where a lot of research is happening in yoga therapy. We all know that yoga works, but research here in Arogyadhama is intended to deliver the reasons why yoga works. So we will take you to Anveshana as well. And then finally, we have Arogyadhama, which is a 250-bed hospital, which is divided into different departments or sections, catering to illnesses of various kinds. You know, it could be mental illnesses, it could be gastrointestinal, it could be back pain and skeletal issues, it could be even be cancer. So there are a number of, there are about 8 sections here in Aarogyadhama which cater to different illnesses, and we will take you through the regular routine that therapy participants, we don't call them patients, we call them therapy participants, that they go through in Aarogyadhama. So welcome once again, and hope this is quite a fruitful journey for digital wellness. Thank you.
Introduce you to you my gurus, Dr. H.R. Nagendra and Dr. Nagaratna. It would be an interesting story to recount how it all of this happened and how did this begin. But before that, a very brief biographical sketch of Dr. Nagendra and Dr. Nagaratna. You may be aware that Dr. Nagendra is a scientist by heart, by profession. He has a PhD in mechanical engineering from Indian Institute of Science, and then post that he has worked with universities in Canada. He's been a consultant with Harvard. He has worked with the NASA. He's also taught engineering in England before coming back to India. He also has patents in his name in his field of mechanical engineering. Dr. Nagaratna is a medical doctor. She's done her MD, and she also is an FRCP holder. And both of them, you know, have now given us the gift of yoga with very specific focus on therapy, on the therapeutical elements of yoga. Now, the interesting point really is, you know, how did this begin and what was the need for doing this, and in what way they proceeded in making this happen. It's close to a 40-year journey, and in terms of, you know, where we are, we need to look at the, you know, the foresight and the wisdom that they had when they began the journey to see what needs to be done to bring yoga to its current state. Hindsight is always 20/20, but foresight 40 years ago to recognize what is to be done and actually do it with a lot of persistence, without any support, you know, either be the ecosystem or the government or anybody for that matter. You know, imagine yourself 40 years ago on how it would be. So they have actually done.
We will be now going to Tarangini to meet Dr. H.R. Nagendra and Dr. R. Nagaratna to understand from them this whole concept of Vyasa and how yoga is being used for therapeutic Namaste Guruji. It is my great pleasure that you are talking to Digital Wellness. We understand yoga is a connection between body, mind and soul. What are your viewpoints on that, Guruji?
Yoga is very comprehensive, and it helps in dealing with the human system in its totality. If the modern medical system deals essentially with the physical body, yoga therapy deals with the human body, and then the subtle and the causal bodies, and that is what has been told in Vedanta and the Upanishads. So when you go into the little more detail of the Upanishads, we all have these 5 koshas. 5 kosha is the physical body, is called as the Annamaya kosha. Then we have Pranamaya, Manomaya, Vijnana, Anandamaya kosha. So similarly, in the world at large, the physical world is made of the electromagnetic field. Then we have the bioplasmic field, the pranic field, then astral field or the mind field. Then we have the information field or the Vijnanamaya kosha. Then finally the bliss field. All these fields are in container interaction going on. Change in one is going to bring change in the other. You know? And this is called the entire creation. In Sanskrit it's called Jagat. Jagat means that which goes on changing is called Jagat. That which does not change is our original state. Mm-hmm. That is a state of perfection with infinite power, infinite knowledge, infinite freedom, infinite bliss. That's our original state. Patanjali called it as the Swarupa, our original state. So that's the whole concept which has been given by our Upanishads and in our ancient yoga texts. So that we have brought to deal with these modern ailments, yoga therapy. For example, yoga problems, such as non-communicable diseases start in the Manomaya Kosha, comes down to physical body, becomes a Vyadhi, Adi becomes a Vyadhi. What all we do in the normal medical field is to deal with the physical body, whereas the root cause is not removed. Therefore, most of these senses have been made as incurable. Therefore, we have tried to remove the root cause, therefore, this can completely get normalized. Reversible things that can happen.
I was going through your profile. I was personally curious. You were a scientist at NASA and you came down here and have started such a beautiful initiative like the Arogya Dhama. One thing always comes to my mind, is yoga more science or is yoga an art?
Yeah, in a sense it is both. Essentially it is a science. I look at the whole thing as a science, because yoga gives us the total knowledge base of the whole creation. The modern science deals only with the physical thing. As I said, these 5 layers, the entire thing. So science is moving towards the subtle things from the physical grass thing. That's what is happening today. So this is what fascinated me, to move from mechanical engineering to human engineering, in a sense. In search of reality, we have stopped or we have gone up to the physical world, and the time has come that we have to go beyond the physical. That's how I entered into this, as a continuation of my journey in the field of research in search for reality. And as I started getting into Upanishads and other, I got very fascinated. Okay, this is where I have to go, this is the direction that I have to give. And the journey continues.
Right. So, you said about in search of reality. One, of course, from your shift from the mechanical engineering to human engineering. In this path of searching reality, we see when somebody talks about wellness, yoga, we see so much of that being said on, if you will have to achieve, say, a health, this much of percentage of asanas has to be done, this much has to be done for diet, etc., etc. So, from a holistic well-being or a holistic wellness standpoint, what is your viewpoint, Guruji?
So if we have to look at man in his total perspective and use the different techniques that yoga offers. And in most generalized form, we have 4 streams of yoga: Jnana Yoga, Raja Yoga, Bhakti Yoga, Karma Yoga. You can deal with your intellect to go towards the highest levels of reality. Or use the power of mind, willpower, to reach that. That's the Raja Yoga. Use the emotional aspect, that's the Bhakti Yoga. And you convert every action into yoga, that's the Karma Yoga dimension. Using any of these things, you can reach the highest level. Process of transformation from our present level to great levels and become a divine human being and reach the highest has been the goal of yoga. Yoga helps to go in this direction. It is not only for health application, it has got the applications in every field. That is the dimensions of yoga that we have. But we have concentrated on therapeutic application because Dr. Nagaratna is there and she is the medical expert, and then we wanted to tackle whether we can deal with these non-communicable diseases which have been considered to be incurable. We are thinking, why it cannot be cured, why it cannot be cured? With all the tremendous achievements we have done in the pharmacological world and the surgical interventions, why we cannot do? Then we came to understand that the subtle thing, the root cause for this, is not tackled. Therefore, we deal only with the symptoms of the external thing. So we had to work on that. Then we said, okay, when we have to deal with that, whether we have really any evidence to show that things will happen. That's how we started the journey, published papers, and it's going on, the journey.
Right. So at Arogya Dhama, you focused a lot more on evidence-based medicine. And also, you spoke about non-communicable disease, because
that is easier to handle. So I know now there is, especially I'm talking to you during the COVID times, I of course have that curious question to Dr. Nagbhatna, but your viewpoint on how, you know, can that not be handled with, you know, practicing of yoga?
Yeah, COVID. That's why we have done a lot of work in this direction, and we had developed a specific module to deal with that. So it will strengthen the immune system. Therefore, immune system will take care of the coronavirus.
Right.
That's our approach.
Right.
Whereas what we do in the modern medicine, you develop a vaccine or you develop a treatment thing to kill those viruses which come. But our immune system, it is very strong. It will take care of that. It will remove this thing.
Yes.
That's the basic approach of yoga or Ayurveda and others, to strengthen the immune system, which will take care of it. Therefore, it's a generalized system. But today, one virus will come, tomorrow another virus will come, another virus will come. That will go on. But if immune system is strong, then it will take care of any virus that comes.
So, so you are combining Ayurveda and all, you know.
Here we have an integrative system. Right. Yoga, then naturopathy, Ayurveda, physiotherapy, acupuncture, all these things combined in our Arogyadhama,
right,
part of the integrative medical system.
So you have in-house patients?
Sure, we have.
I know I have a plethora of questions, but in the interest of time, I think this was very educative and extremely important to Digital Wellness. Thank you so much, Guruji.
Very well.
Namaste.
Namaste.
Welcome to Digital Wellness. I'm extremely happy and honored to be speaking to you, Didi. My first question to you is, you are a medical doctor by profession.
Yeah.
And what was your motivation to start Arogyadhama?
As early as 1970s, when I did my postgraduate studies both in India and abroad, there was already enough knowledge in the medical science which said, particularly I was working in rheumatology in UK. I used to have lines of patients lying in my ward who have got rheumatoid, all joints displaced and 20 joints replaced, 5 joints replaced, deformed. At that time also, in 70s itself, medical science had already shown that it is all mind-body disease. It had already shown it is a non-communicable disease where lifestyle is the important factor. Stress can influence the immune system can affect the joint by autoimmunity. All these were proven, and now in the last 50 years, there is much more knowledge on this. But what medical science does not know is what to do with this monkey mind.
Mm-hmm.
How the monkey mind can work on this body to cause damage is well known. But it is our sages who knew, starting from the mind. They were not so much worried about what exactly happens, which chemical comes, what inflammation happens. All these are like the branches of the tree. The root is the mind. So they started with the mind and started studying the mind, and 5,000 years of research of what to do with the mind, how to handle the mind, what are the problems in the mind, what are the kleshas, what are the vrittis, how to handle that, how to delete this negative aspect of the mind has been very clearly elaborated and studied, and techniques have been evolved. Therefore, it was our duty as this citizens of this motherland to unravel this and give it to the people around. And the only way was to start it with evidence-based medicine, implement it, find out what are the practices, how to do it, what to do it, and how to document it, how to show the results was the need of the hour. So it started all in 1985, our Arogyadhama, and since then we have had good amount of experience in this area.
You know, one of the key things that I saw at Arogyadhama was you actually do a lot of the drugless therapy.
Exactly.
You know, the minute you, someone says Douglas therapy, today if you really ask me, if I go with a particular pain, right, I definitely would get at least four, in my prescription pill, I would get four medicines to be taken. One for the pain itself, the other one would be multivitamins, the third one would be calcium, and fourth one would be my age related. So, I mean, first of all, how do you address patients to believe that drugless therapy can work? And two, I'm also curious to know, does it really work?
See, we are not talking about druglessness is not our criteria. Make the person healthy. Then automatically drugs drop off. See, if I was to practice only as an allopathic doctor, I had no choice. I had to prescribe what my seniors taught me. I have to prescribe how to cut the branches. Although medical science has taught us the root is the mind, what do I do with the mind? What techniques are there? Apart from telling the participant, please don't get stressed. Nobody wants to be stressed, but it comes. So we need a technique. So all our research over the years has been as add-on. Our very first publication in 1985 for asthma was, we used to get severe asthmatics. I can't stop the medication just because I want to call it a drugless therapy. We said, please continue to take your medicine. I'll teach you yoga. I'll teach you the specific practice that is suitable for you. We went on adding, documenting the need for the medication, observed their lung functions, observed their clinical symptoms, and then automatically the drug requirement reduced. So druglessness happens.
Right. So, you know, one of the other areas which is at least getting very popular now thanks to the internet is lifestyle medicine. Right? People want to adopt to lifestyle medicine. And of course, I think Arogya Dhoma is definitely the epitome. In my, you know, after what I saw and what I've read so much about Arogya Dhoma is definitely a big epitome for
lifestyle.
Because I think prevention is better than cure. Because, you know, better prevention than cure. But there are certain things, like for example, diabetes. You know, while you can follow a lifestyle transformation or a change, but sometimes it's also genetic. Sometimes it's genetic also, right? Sometimes, right? For example, if you look at, you know, myself, my mother has been a highly diabetic. So the chances of, say, me getting to a diabetic stage is definitely there. So how do you address those kind of issues?
In all these conditions, which are the major killers, major illnesses that we are seeing today, including COVID, very clearly it has been shown that there is a genetic tendency. It's not a genetic disease. Genetic tendency is different from genetic disease. Genetic disease may be a sickle cell anemia, or shape of the nose is not right, or one bimb is missing. These are all genetically determined diseases. But these are all not genetically determined diseases. Genetic tendency is there. That means out of 1,000 genes that you have, which have expressed already to make you what you are, there are another 200 genes which are there in your body, but they have not expressed. Lifestyle makes these genes express. So that's why lifestyle, these are all called as lifestyle diseases, which makes the dormant gene express, and that dormant gene I have inherited from my parents, but it is dormant. It will express if my lifestyle becomes disturbed. So if you restore the lifestyle, this will go back to sleep. So all that we are doing in diabetes patients who come here with insulin dependency, when they go back without insulin, we have put those genes to sleep, because the factor that was making that gene express is reversed now.
Right.
We have had several examples of people who have been able to come back to normalcy. That is why asthma, where it may be asthma or diabetes, hypertension, where people have completely reversed their condition, come out of their medication, maintain their quality of life, maintain their hemoglobins, maintain their HbA1c's without any complications, but all properly documented, of course.
So do you have programs at Arogyadhama where especially a lot of, like you said, non-communicable and the lifestyle diseases, do you have a program where you define that how much does a person have to spend time at Arogyadhama?
Very clearly. It's not only inpatient, we have got outpatient Arogyadhama also, where people can come to the center 2 hours a day, where there's first there is a consultation, we go through all their records, document them, decide what are the yoga practices they should do, what diet they should do, how much stress counseling has to happen, how to help them to change their habits. All this is planned at this initial stage. When they come to Arogyadhama, this is a more intensive program from 5:30 a.m. to 9 p.m. as a inpatient. But outpatient, they come 2 hours a day, our centers in several parts of the country, both in Bangalore. In Bangalore itself, there are almost 20-30 places where we allot them, because staying at home, not all of them can come to the Arogyadhama here. But the design is very, very important. Our trained MD doctors know what practices to prescribe, both from the yoga point of view, you call it as yoga specific special technique for the disease, what diet to advise, and most important is stress management. See, we know that in lifestyle there are 4 things: diet, junk food, lack of physical activity, both together put them into obesity, which is the root cause for many of these bad habits. And bad habits, not only alcohol or smoking, but wrong sleeping timings, wrong eating timings, wrong habits, mobile habits, which makes you much more this one. And behind all this is the mind management. What I want to say is, we have been talking about lifestyle for 50 years, madam. But why diabetes is increasing?
Right.
Why hypertension is increasing?
Right.
Because we know that what I should eat, what I should not eat. But it is the monkey mind which does not allow me.
Right.
I know that exercise is important, but I cannot do it. Habits, mind. Stress, mind. So this is where mind management techniques are necessary, even for the medical science to incorporate. And it is our sages who have given hundreds of techniques to handle the mind.
You know, you beautifully said about mind management. That's the root cause. And
exactly,
while everybody has a prescription of lifestyle disease management, it is about you. How do you
behavioral change?
Absolutely. I have a plethora of questions, Didi, but I know in the interest of time, I have only touched the surface, but I'm really glad, and I'm sure everybody at Digital Wellness would be extremely happy to have got these words of wisdom from yourself. But thank you so much once again.
Thank you.
As I come to the end of the first episode, there is a deep sense of fulfillment and also feel really enlightened after my conversation with Dr. H.R. Nagendra and Dr. R. Nagaratna. Stay with me for more deeper experiences of Vyasa, Arogyadhama, Anveshana in the following episodes. Please like, subscribe and stay tuned with Digital Wellness. Thank you very much.